Welcome back to another Crypto Gorilla video. It's the end of the week where we recap the biggest news stories in all of Web3. I'm gonna be expanding my videos to include a lot more about crypto, which means I'm looking to hire more people. So if you spend your days researching altcoins, DeFi, GameFi, you might be exactly the person I'm looking for. So I'm gonna put a form down below if you wanna sign up. Maybe I'll be contacting you in the near future. As usual, I'm not a financial advisor. All of this is just my opinion. And if you haven't already done so, would you kindly hit that subscribe button? Starting off with NFT news, Genkai, a project out of CyberKongs, finally announced the details for their upcoming mint, which is scheduled to happen on July 27th. Now, this did seem to cause some controversy as they're going to be trying to sell 9,000 NFTs at a 0.25 ETH mint price with a total supply of 20,000 NFTs, 7,000 of which are going to be airdropped and locked for 180 days, unless the holder is willing to pay a 0.25 unlock fee, and then the remaining 4,000 are redacted. Now, with the recent downfall of Azuki with their Elementals mint, as well as Ether having to reduce their supply, their mint price, and really just change their entire mint structure, I do question Genkai's ability to sell out this collection. If we take a look on NFT Go, we don't even have 9,000 unique people on Ethereum trading NFTs within a 24-hour period. So I do question where they think this demand is going to be coming from. If there's no secondary demand, there's no upside for minters, and if these aren't flippable, nobody's here to donate the last of our money. Now, playing devil's advocate, CyberKongs have supported and do get support from a ton of projects. They are an OG project in the space, and they also have really tight connections with Memeland, with Kyungs, and Ray even went as far as buying a CyberKong last week. So in my opinion, I do feel these are overpriced for the current market. However, I do look forward to hearing more information out of this project, especially what their intention is with the $4 million they're trying to raise. Now, it's also unfortunate for Genkai that on the same day they announced their mint price, Pentoshi tried to mint 10,000 NFTs for 0.2 ETH. I know a lot of people were expecting these to be a free mint, but he somehow managed to mint 2,600 of them, and they are currently sitting slightly under their mint price. Next up, we had an announcement out of Kaiju Kings dropping a trailer for Kaiju Origins, The Journals of Stodd, set to release on August 22nd. And based on this tweet from Dots, it does seem like this is going to be a brand new mint. He does mention that this is going to be non-dilutive and accessible to everyone. So I assume it's going to be similar to their scientist mint and hopefully not a 0.25 ETH mint price. So I love Kaiju Kings. I have a bunch of their merch, but I fear for any collection trying to launch a new collection in these market conditions, especially when their current floor price prices are at their all-time lows. Next, we finally get to see Mythical Moonbirds as their reveal has begun. At the time of filming this video, there have only been 2 sales for the Mythical Moonbirds. So if you do want one of these, you are much better off buying an unrevealed egg, as the floor price is much cheaper and you do have a shot at a rare mythical. However, considering the reveal method is a slow drip reveal, you are gonna have to wait potentially quite a while before seeing which bird you got. Now, had this dropped a long time ago, these would have been flying off the shelf. However, considering the current state of Moonbirds, they're having a tough time shaking up the market. Now, Proof, the company behind Moonbirds, also dropped an announcement for Grails 4, where buyers will be able to select an NFT from various artists. However, the artist name is going to be kept secret, so I'm assuming the NFT itself is already going to be revealed. If not, this is no different than like a regular NFT reveal. However, if that's the case and the only thing hidden is the artist's name, there's potentially a strategy here, as if you're able to recognize a certain artist work and their work sells a lot more than all the other artists on this list, you might be able to pick out a piece that's going to have a much higher floor price. Finally, Doodles did drop some sneak peeks for their upcoming store in collaboration with Camps, which is set to open on August 19th. The store itself will include unique Doodles experiences and activities, as well as Doodle themed apparel and accessories. Moving into brand news, Gucci has partnered with Christie's to host their very own digital collectible auction. The auction is currently live until July 25th and features pieces from notable artists such as Robbie Barrett, Tyler Hobbs, and many more. Next, we saw NFL star Patrick Mahomes retweet an account called Museum of Mahomes. There's still not too many details of what this is. All you can do on the website is sign up to their newsletter. But if I had to guess, I would say this is some sort of digital collectible commemorating Patrick Mahomes' career and some of his best plays in the NFL. Now, the project is being produced in collaboration with Dom, who, of have worked with projects such as Lamborghini, Eminem, and Ferocious. Warner Brothers also launched their third Web3 movie experience, which is The Flash. Now, prior to this, they did Superman and Lord of the Rings. However, personally, I am really not a fan of these types of drops. I feel they could be doing much higher quality stuff with the IPs they have in their hands. So hopefully in the future, now that these three experiences are done, Warner Brothers is going to step up their game and release higher quality stuff. To close off the brand news section, we have Ducati entering Web3 in partnership with Ripple. So I'm guessing NFTs on the XRP ledger. Registration opens up on July 26th. And although we don't know what this is going to be, based on the description, they say it showcases their past, present, and future. So I'm guessing it's just going to be collectibles with not too much utility. I feel like most brands shouldn't be doing these big NFT drops, but should instead look to the blockchain and NFTs for the technology itself and do something like build a great loyalty program for their existing and future customers. So if any brands are watching this and you want assistance, I'm going to put a link down below for my consulting firm where we help brands launch different projects. Jumping into gaming news, Block Games dropped their website along with this trailer for what they are calling the Player Network. Now, if we check the About section on their website, we could see that they are an affiliate with Estuti, if I pronounce that correctly, which is a gaming studio with over 40 mobile games and 50 million monthly active players. Now, at the base level, it does seem like they turn any game into a play and earn game, where players are able to earn rewards for things like referrals, on-chain activities, engagement, and completing achievements, all while allowing companies to acquire more players. Now, they will have an NFT in the near future. It's going to be a free mint, so no risk. I'm going to put a pre-mint link, it's open to the public, in the description down below. Continuing in gaming news, we also saw Ubisoft join Kronos as one of their validators. I'm personally not too familiar with Kronos. It does seem like they offer dev tools like their Kronos Play, which works with both Unity and Unreal Engine. However, it's great to see Ubisoft double down on their Web3 exposure, despite all the backlash they are getting from gamers. In some unfortunate gaming news, we have Neopets announcing that they will be shutting down their Neopets Metaverse project for reasons unknown other than them bringing in new leadership. So it's unclear what's going to happen for their various NFT collections. They do mention in this tweet that they will continue to support the community and keep the Discord open. But if you invested in these NFTs, it's not looking too good. Next up, we finally got the Arkham airdrop, for which the price of their token currently sits at roughly 58 cents. Most people who got it seem to have received roughly a few hundred dollars. However, some of their early adopters, like my boy Captain Y, received close to 2 Ethereum, which is like $4,000. So congratulations, Captain Y. And if you're like me and you signed up really early, you used the app, you were super excited, but then you didn't submit your wallet, you got absolutely nothing. Next, we had OpenSea teasing us earlier this week with a tweet that a lot of people thought was going to be a token. However, in the replies, they quickly squashed our dreams. However, we found out that what this is going to be is replacing OTC deals, as you're now able to trade NFTs for NFTs and tokens combined directly through OpenSea, which is going to save a bunch of people a ton of hassle. Now, you are still limited, as you can only trade NFTs on the same blockchain, and this does not work with 1155 contracts. And I'm also wondering, does this allow you to avoid fees, since you can do NFTs for NFTs plus WEETH? So if I want to buy an NFT and I do an OTC deal with somebody where I negotiate a price and then I put the amount of ETH plus a useless NFT that I have in my wallet that I know is not a drainer, am I able to go around the 2.5% fee as well as royalties? I'll have to test that one out for myself. Next, we have Gnosis, the company behind Gnosis Safe, partnering with Visa to launch their very own credit card in Europe and soon in Hong Kong, allowing their users to spend self-custodied crypto. Now, I think this is a great idea, especially for companies that have a multi-sig wallet, as long as you limit how much can be spent, of course. However, I often talk to employees from NFT projects who tell me how much of a nightmare it is when they need to approve very small transactions, especially if they want to just sign up to a SaaS service and you have to get a bunch of people to approve it and then get the money from the vault and transfer it. Here, you're just going to have a credit card. You could sign up and it's going to take the money directly. Next up in news, FedNow has finally launched, which is a payment service offered by the Federal Reserve for faster payments that banks and credit unions can offer their customers for instant payments. Now, the Fed specifically mentions reasons that this has nothing to do with central bank digital currencies. But in my opinion, this is just a brick by brick strategy where they slowly lure us in and get us to start using all of these services and eventually just hit us with these CBDCs, which we know are coming. Next up, it seems that Bitcoin has friends on both sides of the aisle, as presidential candidate Robert Kennedy Jr. says he will remove capital gains taxes on conversions from Bitcoin to USD, which would be massive for Bitcoin holders. And the intent behind this is to facilitate innovation as well as incentivize investment in America. Closing off with some fundraising news, although we are still only in the third week of July, we've already surpassed the entire month of June for amounts raised. However, if you look at this two-year chart, you can see we are still in the lowest period compared to previous times. If you exclude this $7.8 billion raised in March, which is being propped up by Stripe, who raised $6.5 billion, so let's not count that. Now, the biggest raise of the week was by Polychain Capital. They raised $200 million, and they are a blockchain-focused hedge fund backed by companies like A16Z and Pantera Capital. Next, we have a $54 million raise by Futureverse, which is a company focused on AI and metaverse technology. Now, if you don't know Futureverse, they are building a ton of different things, including payment SDKs and a marketplace API. However, most people in the NFT world probably know them as the company behind Fluffworld, which is a popular NFT collection that minted back in 2021 and have since minted a few collections. Next up, we have Manta raising $25 million in their Series A, led by Polychain Capital, the company I just mentioned two timestamps ago. It seems they have both an L1 and an L2. I'm not too familiar with the Manta blockchains. However, it does seem that their testnet is live, so perhaps in the distant future, they are going to have a token airdrop. Finally, a more modest raise than all the other ones on today's list, we have Interface raising $1.4 million for their social wallet tracking app. If we take a look at the sneak peeks of this app on the website, it does look pretty cool. I think most of us are used to tracking wallets through Discord pings. However, here you get images, you get descriptions, you get to see exactly what people are doing, like in this example, voting on the NounsDAO proposal. I do believe this app is token gated, unfortunately. They do have an NFT. However, it didn't seem to go too well. If you look on the website, it says only 150 of 2,000 have sold, but they now have that VC money, so they have plenty of runway to keep building. That's it for today's video. If you enjoyed it, be sure to hit that like button, give it a retweet. If you haven't already done so, would you kindly hit that subscribe button, smash that bell notification. Thank you for watching the Crypto Gorilla. Peace.